I'd like to first give honor to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I'd like to give honor to Pastor Reed and to the fellow ministers in the house. It's truly an honor to be here once again before you. And for those of you on social media, we say good morning to you as well. For the sake of time, I'm going to ask if you would grab your Bibles and turn with me to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. And we're just going to read verses 16 and 17 together. Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. And when you have found it, I'm going to ask you to stand in reverence to the reading of the Word of God. Now let's read together. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed, from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Father God, we come to you right now in the blessed name of Jesus. Father God, we just thank you today for your word. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for deliverance. And we thank you for healing. And Father God, we just ask right now in the blessed name of Jesus that your word would go forth with power this morning and might and travel beyond the walls of this building to those folks in social media this morning. Father God, we just ask that you would save, that you would deliver, that you would set free and make whole. And Father God, I give you the glory this morning. I give you all the honor and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I would like to use for just a few moments the subject, the gift of the gospel. The gift of the gospel. Romans, Paul's early letter to the church at Rome, I believe is perhaps the most powerful, introspective, and thorough book found in the New Testament. Paul was writing this letter to present the basic system of salvation to a church that had not received teaching from an apostle before. It is in Romans where Paul explains that as believers, we were baptized into Jesus Christ. We came into a covenant relationship with God through Jesus. We became children. We became heirs. And we came into a spiritual contract with God that is now eternal. And Paul also lets us know in Romans that no demon, no power, no authority above the earth, on the earth, or under the earth can separate us from the love of God. So once you are saved, once you become part of God's family, God seals us with his spirit. God takes ownership of us for the first time. That is when God claims us. And when God claims us, we can then say he is our heavenly Father.
Amen.
Here in our text this morning, we find the Apostle Paul explaining to the believers at Rome that as believers, that they were redeemed by Jesus. In other words, they were bought with a price. They were made valuable to God through Jesus Christ. But if you do a good exegesis of the book of Romans, you will find that the Romans, as well as the Greeks, worshiped many false gods, images, of wood, metal, and stone. And it was so bad that the government even collected taxes to erect temples to these images. And it was these tax dollars that was used to maintain these temples. But God had told his people years ago that he is a jealous God and thou shalt have no other gods before.
Amen.
But over time, even the Jews, God's people has started to accept and participate in these heathen practices. And one thing, church, we need to know about God is that God never changes. His word never changes. God said that I am the same God today, that I was yesterday, that I'll be tomorrow, and forevermore. If it was wicked to God 6,000 years ago, it's wicked to God right now.
Amen.
If God said no back then, the answer is still no right now.
Amen.
Because God says that I am that I am. I am El Olam, the everlasting, eternal, unchanging, and consistent God.
Amen.
Church, God never changes.
Amen.
Although God had planted this church in Rome, the influences surrounding that church were still a threat. And just like today in our church, the influences that are surrounding our church is still a threat to us right now. About a year ago, I can't remember if it was CNN or C-SPAN, there were these liberal groups that were demanding that the Church of England start marrying gay people. And the Church of England stood its ground and said no. And there are groups here that want to take our tax exempt status here if we don't start marrying gay people.
Yes.
But the Bible says that marriage is an institution that was first created by God.
Amen.
And God intended one man,
yes,
one woman, one lifetime.
Yes.
Amen.
A marriage, according to the Bible, represents the relationship that's going to happen between Christ, the groom, and the church.
Yes.
So when two men or two women get married, it's just a parity of what God intended to happen. And my response to those liberal groups who are pushing this evil, demonic agenda is woe unto them who call evil good. In other words, when we applaud evil, when we support that which is ungodly, what's going to happen is we are going to unleash the full wrath of God upon ourselves. Some of that wrath is going to be felt on this side of the grave. It may come in the form of AIDS. It may come in a form of cancer. It may even come in a form of a violent death. But then we're going to see the wrath of God on the other side of the grave.
Amen.
Yes.
John said in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 11, he said, I saw them great and small standing before the white throne.
Yes.
These are people who did not accept Jesus Christ.
Yes.
These are people who died without Christ. And the Bible tells us that it's going to be a bad and sad day during that time.
Yes.
There are many people who are going to say, Lord, I came to church every Sunday.
Yes.
Lord, I led this one to Christ and I led that one to Christ. I did all kinds of good works and I did all kinds of charitable things. And he's going to say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, for I knew you not. And the Bible says those folks are going to be judged by two books. I call them the book of deeds. God has his own mandatory sentencing guidelines. Just like New Jersey and Texas have their sentencing guidelines, God has his.
Amen.
And the reason why God has them is because the Bible says that God is just. All of those people are not going to the same part of hell, but they're all going to hell. And just so you know, there are no good parts down there.
Yeah.
There's not going to be no Las Vegas down there. There's not going to be no dance in the Soul Train line down there. It's going to be hell down there. All parts of it is bad. It just gets worse and worse and worse depending on what level you are going to.
Amen.
You don't want to go there.
Amen.
Nobody wants to go there. It's not even something that we should joke about. Amen.
Amen.
Here this morning in Romans chapter 1, starting at verse 16, Paul said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ." Now, if you notice, Paul uses the personal pronoun I. He uses the personal pronoun I because Paul has a lot of experience. If you go back to Acts chapter 9, you will find Paul going around and persecuting the Christians. He was having them locked up. He was having them beaten. He was having them killed because he was trying to wipe out the gospel message of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Paul did not believe that God would send a son down here from heaven to be born of a Virgin Mary and to die upon a tree. Paul thought that was crazy. Paul thought it was lunacy. And Paul was determined that he was going to wipe this doctrine from the earth. And the Bible said that he was on his way to Damascus. And while he was on his way to Damascus, the Bible said a light shone down from heaven and knocked him down. Sometimes God has to knock us down. And you don't want God to knock you down. It's better to just get down on your knees on your own than to have God knock you down. But Paul was so callous and he was so hard, God had to knock him down to humble him. And then God spoke to him from heaven and said, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" And what I like about it is Saul was trembling. Big, bad Saul was trembling and shaking. And he said, "Who art thou, Lord?" And Jesus said, "I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest." And instead of getting bad, now Saul humbled himself, probably for the first time. And he said, "What shall thou have me to do?" And Jesus said, "Get up and go to the city of Damascus, and it will be told thee what thou must do."
Yes.
Now, what's so interesting about Saul's case is Saul had been studying the Old Testament ever since he was a little boy. He had studied the law. He had studied the writings. He had studied all of that wisdom literature, but he couldn't see Jesus between lines. And God had to knock him down. So we find Paul here saying, "I am not ashamed of the gospel," because God could have killed him that day. God could have took him into eternity that day, but God showed mercy. God showed mercy to give Saul a chance to get his act together. And if you don't know Jesus today, and you're alive today, God is giving you a chance today to get your act together.
Amen.
Don't let God knock you down.
Amen.
You need to get down right now and accept Jesus Christ as Lord.
Amen.
He says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ." If you are saved this morning, you need to go back and look at where you came from. And where God has brought you up right now.
Amen.
There was a young lady here at the church, and I'm going to share her story because she's got up behind here and shared it publicly many times. And she shared it with many of you privately many times. But this young lady was living with this guy when she first came to this church. And I remember when I first met her, she would, I can't remember what she called him, Snuggly Man or something like that, but she was in love with this man.
Yes.
But she heard the gospel message being preached in this church.
Yes.
And she accepted
Yes.
What the gospel message said. So when she went back home and she moved out of that situation.
Yes.
And she said, the man, she told the man, I love you very much, but what we are doing is not right. Yes. And the man thought there was something wrong with him, and it wasn't something wrong with him. She was convicted.
Yes.
She was convicted by the Spirit of God.
Yes.
And you know what the Bible says? It says here, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. And then he says, for it is the power of God.
Amen.
Why does he call it the power of God? He calls it the power of God because it has the power to convict us when we hear it.
Amen.
If you have your Bible, go to Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12. Now I'm using the NIV. And the writer here is talking about the word of God. He says, for the word of God is alive and is active. When you read Shakespeare, when you read Dickens, Longfellow, or whatever that other guy was, Henry David Thoreau, all of those writings are fictional. But this writing is alive and is active.
Yes.
Why is that? Well, Paul tells us why in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16. And this is what Paul says. He says, all scripture, everything in here, is God-breathed. In other words, all scripture comes from the mouth of God. He used different men to give it to us, but it ultimately comes from God. It ultimately comes from heaven down to us. And he says, and it is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in what? In righteousness. So the writer says, for the word of God is alive and active, and he said it's sharper than any double-edged sword. And what does it do? Well, what it does, I can hardly read. Let me get my light out here. I can hardly see. It penetrates even as the dividing soul and spirit and joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitude of the heart. The word of God has convicting power.
Amen.
When you came up here or in any other church and you gave your life to Christ, the reason why you gave your life to Christ is because when you heard the word of God being preached or taught for the first time, it convicted you.
Yes.
And it brought you up to where you would accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And that's why Paul says, and you have he quickened. He made us alive. The word of God revives us. It refreshes us. It brings us to life. You know, before we came to Christ, we were like someone that was on a deathbed. And we had been declared dead. And the doctors and nurses are trying to resuscitate us. And they got the defibrillator machine going, and you're laying there, and then someone whispers the word of God. And when you hear that word of God for the first time, your eyes start to flutter. And your leg starts to move. And you jump up out of that bed and you accept Jesus Christ for the first time. And you are now truly living in Christ. Because the Bible said that we were dead in trespasses and sins before we came to Christ. But Jesus, the giver of life, Jesus, the reviver of life, resuscitated us And he brought us out of darkness, and he did something else for us. He empowered us to live a life free from the bondage of sin. God has the power not only to save us, but God has the power to deliver us.
Amen. Amen.
Nobody has to live in bondage. Yes. We don't have to live in sexual bondage.
Yes. Amen.
We don't have to live in lying.
Amen.
We don't have to live in alcoholism.
Amen.
We don't have to live in drugs.
Amen.
No matter what's going on around us. I heard Brother Charles say one time, you can be kept if you want to be kept.
Yes.
The problem is sometimes we really don't want to be kept.
Yes.
And God wants to keep us. And God has given us the power to be kept, but we have to want to be kept.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. It happened when you first heard the gospel message. When you first heard the gospel message and you accepted, and God's spirit bear witness with your spirit, you became alive for the first time. And if you are alive today, you should be like Paul this morning. You should not be ashamed of the gospel. You should be proud of it because you know where you're going. You know where you are on your way, but now you know where you are going, and you should be proud to share the gospel message of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel message of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation in everyone who believeth. You know, before we came to Christ, from the time that we heard the gospel message to the time that we accepted him, there's something that happened in between. And that's something is called faith. You know, over in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 18, Peter identifies Jesus. And he tells Jesus that thou art the Son of God. And the Bible tells us that Jesus was impressed with Peter. And he says something there. He said, I say unto you, Peter, upon this rock, I will build my church. Now, I heard a preacher say that the church was built upon Peter. But that's not what the scripture teaches.
Amen.
The scripture teaches, he said, upon this rock, upon your faith, in believing that I, Jesus, am the Son of God, upon your faith, he says, I will build my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. When we came to Christ, we had to believe that Jesus Christ would save us. We may not have seen fire and angels marching around the church, but we had to believe that if we accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that Jesus was going to save us.
Amen.
The reason why faith is so important, because we can't live without it.
Amen.
We're immobile if we don't have faith. It's like being in the desert without a camel, without legs, without a car, without nothing. If we don't have faith, we're just stuck. But when we have faith, Jesus said, if we have the faith of the mustard seed, he says, ye shall remove mountains. In other words, ye shall resolve problems, big problems.
Yeah.
If you have a problem with your marriage this morning, all I'm going to say is how much faith do you have?
Yeah.
If you have a problem with that boss on your job, and I got some rough ones on my job, I'm going to say is how much faith do you have? If you are in debt right now, and you feel like you will never be able to own your own home, I'm going to say one thing to you. How much faith do you have? Jesus said, if you have the faith of a mustard seed, just a wee little bit of faith, you can do a whole lot.
Amen.
My grandmother used to say, just a little dab would do. Amen? Amen. Now, let me get back to my text here. He says in verse 17, He says, for therein, he's talking about the gospel, the good news of Jesus, for therein is the righteousness of God. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. What he's talking about there is that God is always in the right relationship with his people. God is always in the right relationship with his creation. And God never shares his throne. He never shares his power. He never shares his seat of authority with anybody or anything. He doesn't do that because he's a righteous, perfect God. So he says there, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just are God's children, God's elect. If you are a child of God this morning, you are one of the just. He's talking about those who are growing and developing and maturing in Christ Jesus. He said, the just shall live by faith. The reason why the just shall live by faith, because in this world, the Bible says, ye shall have tribulations. Even us as just folk, we may lose our jobs. We may lose our 401ks. We may lose our pensions. And what he's saying there, that as children of God, we are not going to be dependent on those things. Those things are nice to have while we're down here, but we're going to be dependent on the power of God.
Amen.
We can't depend on Mr. Trump. We can't depend on our spouses and family. What he's saying there is ultimately, we have to be able to depend on God. If we're a righteous people, church, we're a church that's going to continually grow. We're going to grow collectively, but we're also going to grow individually. So our faith is going to get tested. So he says here, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. It's a picture of people who are continuously growing,
yes,
continuously developing, continually getting stronger in the Lord, no matter what goes on around them. No matter what goes on around them, they're not the same this year that they were last year. They're continuously growing and developing in the Lord. And that's why he says that the just shall live by faith. Paul's message this morning is that the gospel is a gift from God.
Yes.
It's a gift that never goes out of style.
Amen.
It's a gift that never depreciates in value. And it's a gift that's given to us freely to anyone who accepts Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Amen. The emphasis here, church, if you notice, God and Jesus are never separated. They're one.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
God and Jesus are never separated. They're one. Jesus is fully God and he was fully man at the same time when he was down here.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
God and Jesus are one. Father God, we come to you right now in the blessed name of Jesus. Father God, we just thank you for your word. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for healing. We thank you for deliverance. We thank you for all of your provisions. Father God, I can just go on and on. Father God, we just want to thank you today for sending Jesus. And Father God, I just ask in the blessed name of Jesus to prick our hearts, even those of us who are saved, so that we can strive toward your perfection. and prick those who are unsaved so they would join your family today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.